course that many of you are excited to take. This is sort of the culmination of your education, being from the chemistry majors. And so let's dive in for a little bit and see what our version of forensic chemistry is here at SAM. Now this degree is unique because it was one of the first forensic chemistry degrees to be put together. There were a few that got on the ball before we did, but a lot of those degrees were, they weren't very rigorous, okay? And Dr. Leffler, Dr. White said, we want our graduates in forensic chemistry to be really good chemists. And so as you well know, this is a tough degree. This is an analytical chemistry degree with this emphasis on criminal justice and forensic science. So you have a minor in criminal justice, and then you have this course at the end, forensic chemistry, that kind of touches on parts of the forensic discipline that aren't covered in a typical chemistry discipline. So, like, we'll get into microscopy a little bit. We'll talk about physical properties. We don't talk that much about physical properties in terms of characteristics, particle size, and so on, in any of the other courses. And yet, those are forensically relevant concepts. So, let's see what we're going to talk about. The beginning third of the course is on quality requirements.
Can we turn like that role
off? Yeah, let's see what we can do. Yeah.
Nope. Let's try this one. I don't know if we can just get the front one.
Okay.
Is this a little clearer?
A little better? Yeah, okay, yeah. Very good. So what we'll do is just focus on this, the quality requirements part of the course, because as you might imagine, you want the forensic chemistry lab to operate at a very high quality. You don't want someone going in and thinking, oh, I think it'd be better this way, and changing the procedure on Monday. And then Tuesday saying, that didn't work, let's try this. And so Tuesday you have a different procedure. And you go to court, and this person's evidence was tried with one, was, you know, tested with one procedure, and this person's evidence with a different procedure. You're playing with people's lives here. So you have to have high quality. You can't have false positives or false negatives. And so what part of the discipline as well is doing things on a schedule. So we'll have this control chart. So this was a particular control chart for Brittany Bazier. I don't know if you all ever met her. She was a graduate probably 4 years ago. And it doesn't really matter what you track in this course, okay? The point is the discipline of tracking it daily on weekdays and then coming up with this control chart. So this was her dog in the morning, the time it took to find a spot. Okay. So this is the time it took spot to find a spot, right? And so she would go out with her phone, and as soon as she left the front door, she'd hit go, and so then little pup would go out. And about 12 seconds was the mean, so pretty prompt little dog. But occasionally, 50 seconds or 90 seconds, or, you know, 50 seconds. So these are definitely out of the norm. Right? So they're out of control, if you will. It's not like she's trying to control her dog. She's just saying the process, when it's in control, should have random variation. And then when it's not varying randomly, that's not random. Right? This variation down here is random. When it's not random, you call it out of control. So this is a quality exercise that we're going to do this semester. And so whenever it's beyond this red mark, we call it the action limit. The action that you take is to investigate why it's out of control. And so she would observe when the dog was taking a long time, she noticed that it was somebody walking by on the sidewalk and the dog's barking at them, it's distracted, okay? That's not the normal random variation. Normally at 6 in the morning, there's nobody walking on the sidewalk. But 3 days out of that semester, there were. And so on those 3 days, the system was out of control. Now, if you're doing GC or what have you, there may be things, you know, the air conditioning was out this day, and our system didn't behave correctly. We ran a check sample, and it was off, okay? You know why it wasn't in control, because the air handling system has changed. So we'll focus on the quality requirements for the first third of the course. There's just another kind of control chart, a lot more busy, okay, as you can imagine. We'll also focus on false positives and false negatives. And we'll talk about statistical tests. So we'll learn the terms, the statistical terms of the null hypothesis and the alternative hypothesis. And so have y'all had statistics at any level? Have y'all covered these terms?
Okay.
In genetics. All right. Did y'all talk about hypothesis testing in genetics? Okay, good.
And null hypothesis.
Yeah, and so we'll have the same kind of terminology here in forensic chemistry. And so this is sort of a question here. You've got false positives and false negatives. So up here's the true result. You really can't tell which one of these is the case for particular analysis, truly positive or truly negative, unless you use a standard. So you put in, you know it's cocaine, you put it in and you test it. And so it's truly cocaine, but you do the test and it says that it's not. You've got a false negative. Okay. Or you put in talcum powder, it shouldn't be cocaine. You run a test for cocaine on talcum powder and it comes up positive. That's a false positive, right? It's truly a negative result. It should not come up as cocaine. You put talcum powder in the instrument and you get cocaine. Positive test for cocaine, that's a false positive. Which is worse?
False negative? They're both really bad.
They're both really bad, right? And so that's the subjective question. We really can't answer it here, but we can put the statistics out there. This has a false positive rate of one part or one chance in 100, or one chance in 100 there'd be a false negative. And those would be pretty good odds, okay? You'd like it to be better than that. You'd like it to be less than a chance, one chance in a million. When I worked for the nuclear industry, we had a one chance in a billion that it would go off unexpectedly. Okay, so they wanted us to operate under one chance in a billion. And so we would do a lot of statistical tests to make sure that the safety of the system was low enough that we could say there's less than a one in a billion chance that this thing would go off unexpectedly. Then the middle part of the course is chemical and drug analysis. So we're going to do a lot of review of equilibrium chemistry. Remember ice tables? Hey, all right, so we've got ice tables, yeah. And then we're going to learn about aqueous, a pH-dependent solubility in organic and aqueous phases. So we use liquid-liquid extraction, at least on paper, and find out how we can separate multiple components. Like Excedrin has three drugs in it, acetaminophen, Tylenol, and caffeine. And you can use varying solubilities in pH to separate those three. You don't have to use chromatography. You can use just liquid-liquid extraction.
I really wish we had a lab for this. It'd be like really good.
Yeah, I know, it'd be great. I've often thought about that, especially the microscopy parts. You need that's totally skill based. And so you know, finding a focus and making a good slide, those are really tricky skills. We'll talk about a little bit about the instrument. One chapter that's dedicated to instrumentation that y'all have had a whole course on, instrumental analysis. So we're not going to rehash everything that you took in instrumental analysis, but we will focus on a few of the techniques that you didn't cover in that course. And then the last third of the course is physical evidence. So the physical properties, particle size, the character of the different substances, and that's also where I'll put in some of my expertise in explosives. So the book doesn't have much on explosives and explosives analysis, but I have some from my background working for Pantex. And so I'll put in a little bit of information about explosives and really the analysis of physical evidence after the explosion. So what kind of things would you expect to see after a detonation? You know, would you find parts of the case material? Would you find the fire set, the thing that caused it to detonate? Would you find little brass pieces of the detonator? Could you tell what kind of parts this device had from the post-blast analysis? And so that's the overview of the course topics. So let's look at just a little bit of the topics, I mean the specifics of the information that we're going to do. So this is the beginning overview of the discipline of forensic chemistry. So what is forensic chemistry? Well, it's applied analytical chemistry. And so analytical chemistry asks these three questions. What is it? How much is there? And how sure are you? And so the what is it is, again, the chemical identity, or maybe even the physical properties. How much is there? That's quantitative analysis. So you have qualitative analysis with the what is it, quantitative with the how much, and then what is this part? How sure are you? That's the quality control.
Statistics out.
Yeah, so that's the statistical part of it. I can tell you what it is and how much is there just by eyeballing it, but I'm not going to have very good statistics. And so in forensic chemistry, we take analytical chemistry and add in the art and skill and science of comparison. So we're constantly comparing evidence from the scene to evidence that we've collected from other areas to test our hypotheses.
Okay.
And so this exhibition of evidence, we have specific identification called individualization or just classification, right? This is blood. Okay, that's sort of a classification of this red substance, but it's not individualized. Getting DNA from that would be individualization. And so this funnel gets narrower and narrower, and the narrowest part is an individual. But a broad classification, red fluid, it could be paint, it could be blood. What kind of classification is it? And then you get blood. Well, it could be animal blood, or it could be human blood.
Is that classification or individual?
Classification. So
it's
in
like
broad
dog
buckets. Yeah. And then individualization would be, it came from this dog because the DNA matched. Okay. Or just one level above that would be blood type. You know, if you can tell that, A, B, O, et cetera. And so really, that these legal requirements, the word forensic comes from the Roman Forum, where the debating happened. And so what's interesting, that's where the legal profession got its start. If you think about the Roman society was finally peaceful enough that rhetoric became a skill that was valuable. Before that, it was just strength. But once you got to a peaceful society, debate became a valued skill. And so you had the legal profession, argumentation, start to take a better role, a bigger role in society. And so that's where this forensic arguing for your point comes from. And so science, forensic science, is the science that's inside this glove of the legal requirements. Now, the glove is there for good, right? It's protective. But it also restricts, right? You're not quite as agile with gloves on. You don't have the tactile abilities that you do without gloves. But that's the nature that we have to operate in. We have to operate within the legal requirements to do our work as forensic scientists. And so the forensic chemistry today, there's really two large branches of forensic chemistry. There's forensic toxicology, which deals with biological evidence, all the different bodily fluids, decay, the body farm. Maybe some of you have probably done internships out there. But this course is focused on the chemistry side. So we're not on the tox side, we're on the chemistry side. So we're dealing with forensic physical evidence and bulk and trace analysis. So we really aren't going to talk much about, and I know that may upset some of you folks, we're not talking about bodily fluids, drugs, poisons, and decay. We will talk about their chemical nature, but we really won't talk much about the body. We have a section I call baby toxicology. Okay, so we'll talk about absorption, distribution, metabolism, and elimination. But we're not going to get into the biochemical pathways for how this drug is metabolized. Yeah, great stuff, but that's in biochem. All right. And so then part of this quality, this glove that's on the science, is sort of getting the science to work within this quality requirement for the legal profession. And having precedent for using these particular tools in this legal system to handle evidence, that's a real tricky thing. You can't just have fresh graduates come out and bring a procedure that they learned in biochem and apply it to evidence, you know, and not have it hit with 1,000 questions. And so you have these scientific working groups. And so this is something, if you're interested in any of these, you can go into the notes that I'm going to post on Blackboard this afternoon. Actually, these are in the last set of notes, but I'll post them as I finish them today. These are the scientific working groups, and look how specific they are. There's so many on here. I'll just read a few of them. Like right here, scientific working group for imaging technology. So all the camera work and everything, there's a scientific working group for how you set up the photograph, how you illuminate the scene, how you do post-processing, and more importantly, how you document post-processing. Because wouldn't a defense lawyer want to know that you fiddled with the photograph, right? So how do I know you didn't put my client in the scene? here's a you know, a security tape that shows my client, you know, with a gun pointed at the clerk, and you know, the defense may try to argue that was doctored. But if you follow the scientific working group recommendations for imaging technology, then you have a nice, firm foundation to stand on. There's some others here. Firearms and tool marks. fire and explosive scenes, shoe print and tire tread evidence. So I mean, very, very specific. So if you're interested in any one of those things, you can go look up the different findings and manuals and all kinds of reports that these scientific working groups put out. Now let's talk about three basic legal concepts, and this is where you'll need to write some things down. The first case that is a major part of this glove that restricts what we do in forensic science is the Frye rule. And so in general, you want to connect these two. The Frye rule deals with general acceptance. So the general acceptance of evidence. So evidence produced by a scientific analysis is admissible if the techniques are accepted by the relevant scientific community. And so that's that role that the scientific working groups play. If the scientific working group accepts that technique, then it has met general acceptance. So if you try to come up with some crazy technique and no one's ever heard of it, it's not going to be admissible in court because of this precedent-setting case. And so how would you establish that it's been accepted? Well, the scientific working groups would be one way, but peer-reviewed literature would be another. Now, you have the Journal of Forensic Sciences and Forensic Science Communication. It helps if those are forensic journals that are related to the application of science to the legal business. But you might be able to establish that, you know, it was, say, in the Journal of Toxicology. You know, there's no bias against those other journals, but it really is nice if it's in a forensic science related journal. Now you don't have to write down everything on this slide. This is the main thing that you need to write down. The Frye rule is related to general acceptance. Yes?
Well, how does the court know that the lab used that technique in the right method?
Yeah, so you might say, yes, this method is for instance, GC. Okay, I saw this on CSI. This is a great example. So gas chromatography, definitely an accepted method. Okay? But they used it and they said, oh, this soil contains calcium carbonate. Calcium carbonate on a gas chromatograph? You may have a problem with that.
Solid.
What's calcium carbonate?
Solid.
Well, yeah, it's an ionic solid. But it's a rock. It's part of soil. It's not going to fly in a GC. It's not going to. What does GC separate compounds based on in general? You've got your instrumental analysis, right? How are compounds? Why do they elute at different times in the gas chromatograph? They have different what? Boiling points. What's the boiling point of calcium carbonate? I don't know. Lava? Magma? I don't know. You know. So there's an acceptable technique. GC or gas chromatography that's acceptable for use in forensic science, but applied in a ridiculous manner. You're not going to put soil in your GC and detect calcium carbonate. It's going to sit in the inlet and clog everything up. Now you might get junk that's absorbed on to those particles, and you might see organic matter in the soil, but you've just messed up your GC. And so that would be an example. Yes, this is an approved technique used in an unapproved way for a sample that it doesn't apply to. Yeah. Yeah. So you would dissolve it or digest it in some sort of nitric acid or aqua regia.
But how would the court know though?
You would have experts on both sides.
On both sides.
Yeah. And so if the prosecutor put this evidence out, and then the defense would say, "Hold on a minute," you know, they would have their experts to say, you know,
you can't do that.
Yeah, GC separates things based on their boiling point, and this is the range typically, and what would be the boiling point in, you know, of calcium carbonate, and the expert would say, you know, 1700 degrees. You know. And they'd say, what was your inlet temperature? And it says, well, from the report, it says 280 degrees. So you didn't detect
almost
calcium carbonate.
Almost
yeah.
There.
Yeah.
You sure you can't just put soil to it?
Yeah, so that's just crazy. Yeah. And so that's through the expert,
both ways.
Yeah, both sides. And that's the thing. Another part that you may not be familiar with is in any of these cases, you have this thing called discovery. And so the prosecutor needs to give the defense everything they're going to bring to court, all the evidence against their client. And so they would know that they were using gas chromatography as a piece of their evidence. And so the defense would have a chance to get their experts and challenge that. And so everything, all the evidence is out on the table before trial. And so then both sides get to use the same amount of evidence, the same types of evidence, the same evidence, and make a case for both sides. Good. The second one is called Daubert. I know it looks like a French word, but it's based on, I mean, the family that this was in this case, they pronounced their own name Daubert. So we'll go with their own pronunciation of their own name. So the Daubert decision, and it's, again, rules of evidence, and it sets the judge as the gatekeeper for admissibility. So the Fry rule was a generally accepted technique. You know, it was, is this scientific technique generally accepted? But then who makes the decision? Is it the jury? How is this decision made? Well, the Daubert decision says the judge is the one who makes the decision. And so then there's a thing called a Daubert hearing. So if they put the evidence out there and the defense sees in discovery that they're using GC on calcium carbonate, then they can make a challenge and say that evidence is inadmissible because that's not the typical sample you would run on a GC. And it would be the judge's decision to allow that evidence or not. And that would be a Daubert hearing. So the judge would sit down with the prosecution and the defense. This wouldn't be in front of the jury or anything like that. It would be a separate hearing, because you wouldn't want to prejudice the jury to hear the evidence, and then the judge says, no, that's inadmissible, forget you heard that. That happens, and you've seen that in court cases, that happens. But that's not what's desirable, because how do you unhear something, right? So they have the Daubert hearing separate from the case, and don't even let it be presented if it's been ruled inadmissible. Okay. And so some of these things are error rate and peer review, so it gets down to the specifics. If this is a very unreliable technique, it can be challenged and be deemed inadmissible. And then this is related still to scientific evidence. Somebody see that Fry rule was scientific procedures? Are they generally accepted by the community? The Daubert decision says the judge is the gatekeeper, very important role. But still we're talking about scientific evidence. And then the Cuomo decision extended Daubert to where now the judge is the gatekeeper for all expert testimony. So you can bring in somebody that has a psychological analysis, and they're going to bring this psychologist in with their opinions, and the judge could say, well, you know, I think that expert witness is not admissible because they don't have any credentials in psychology. Okay, they just stayed at a Holiday Inn Express. And that's not good enough, okay? So the judge then could say, no, this expert testimony is not admissible, too. So it extended it beyond just scientific evidence.
There's breakthroughs in forensic chemistry all the time. Like, they find new methods to do things. How do you miss those in court?
Yeah, it's very tricky, but that's where the scientific working groups really come into play, because they're the fastest way to look at a new technique.
Okay.
And that was a problem with the attenuated total reflectance, IR. So the ATR that we used in PQM, you put a little drop on there.
Mm-hmm.
You could do the same with powders. You could put a powder on that diamond, press it down, and get a spectrum right away. No sample prep. Whereas the forensically valid way to do that just prior to that was to make a potassium bromide pellet, a KBR pellet. So you get a mortar and pestle, you sprinkle in your sample, which may be, say, a cocaine sample or something like that. You sprinkle it in with potassium bromide, and you grind it for 20 minutes with a mortar and pestle. And then you put it into this little pellet press, and you press it to, like, I don't know, 8,000, 10,000 PSI. So you press it, and that potassium bromide makes a salt crystal with your sample doped in it. And then you put it in the beam of the IR, and you get a beautiful spectrum. Okay, if you didn't put too much. If you put too much, you saturate the spectrum. You got to start over. So you go back, mortar and pestle. Okay. Then you put
in,
and you get and then you put too little. Yeah, you got to start over. So this was sort of like a luck-based black magic type thing of trying to find just the right amount of powder to put in this potassium bromide. And then along comes the attenuated total reflectance attachment. We sprinkle a little powder on there and get a spectrum right away. But the problem is the baseline for ATR is not linear. Because the penetration depth is a function of the wave number value. And so it goes into the sample about 2 microns down in the low frequency range and about 0.2 microns at the CH stretch range. And so your baseline was completely skewed. And so when you compare the ATR spectrum to the library of compounds that you collected over decades with KBR pellets, they didn't match. And so that's where a new technique was challenged in court, because they're like, wait, you collected the sample with ATR, you're comparing it to a KBR library. What if it's not really cocaine? What if my, you know, client is being improperly accused? And so they had to come up with ATR libraries. So that did slow things down, and that's part of that glove. Science is working inside this forensic requirement glove that slows things down a little bit. But now they have ATR libraries, and we're off to the races. So it's wonderful, but it does slow things down. You can't take a technique right into forensic science the first time you get it to work. Now, there's other kinds of evidence that are not they're not chemically identifiable. Let's say you've got a fiber evidence, and you can have evidence that includes or evidence that excludes. These two fibers may be the same chemical exactly. So they may be both high-density polyethylene fibers or rayon fibers or some kind of fiber. And so if you did just a chemical analysis, the chemical analysis would tend to include those two fibers. And you would say, okay, these are included in the group. You know, this we have this evidence and then this evidence from the scene and evidence from this person's carpet are the same chemical. And so you might think that they're included in the same group. But if you look at them, they're completely different. This one has these little striations on it, and this one's smooth. And so that would be exclusive. So you put them in different groups. And so you're thinking always, is this included in the same group or excluded into different groups? And so those are words you need to think about. Is it inclusive or exclusive? Exclusive puts things in different categories. And so if you said that the top fiber came from a suspect and the bottom fiber came from the scene, you'd say those are different fibers, okay? And so that doesn't tend to place that suspect at the scene because the fibers look different. But do you see how problematic it would be if you just went with chemical evidence? They're both polyethylene terephthalate, okay? That would improperly include, whereas just the physical properties excluded. Famous cases where people say this paint and that paint are exactly the same because they're based on chemical analysis, but their set technique wasn't sensitive enough to detect the pigments. And so they're totally different colors, right? Or you do an FTIR and you get the clear coat, and the clear coat is the same on both paints, but the pigment layer is below that and you didn't detect it, and they're different colors. And so there have been embarrassments in the court where people say, yeah, these two paints are the same. And they show the pictures of them, and they're different colors. And you're like, oh. So that's a problem, right? So always that's where microscopy and photography really come into play. If, as a chemist, you might be blind to the physical properties, you know, color and shape and those kinds of things, but they're just as important for this inclusive and exclusive thinking.
Is that viewed in a regular microscope, or...?
Yeah, it just depends. This would be regular, like a stereo microscope. If you get in on a fiber, you know, 10x, you can see this kind of thing. And fibers are incredibly complex. They're not just little tubes like these little green tubes. There are a lot of little triangles, and they just have different properties. And they spin them out through these different shapes to give them a different flexibility, a different feel. There's also direct and indirect evidence. And that's something that you need to get into your mind, that is, there's no weight given, no higher weight given to direct evidence versus indirect evidence. In your CJ classes, have you all talked about direct versus indirect? What is direct evidence? There's only one type of direct evidence. Eyewitness testimony is the only direct evidence. Right? I saw Lucio do it. That's the direct evidence.
Me too.
Okay? I was there and I saw it. And everything else is indirect evidence. Okay? So, you're always instructed by the judge to not put any higher weight on direct evidence versus indirect evidence. In fact, a lot of prosecutors would prefer an indirect case. Okay? Because the evidence is objective. You can look at it. Whereas people and their subjective nature, they, you know, when they're giving testimony, they might embellish things, they might have a grudge or what have you. There may be a lot of psychological reasons for them to twist the story ever so slightly, and you might not be able to tell. But for, you know, chemical analysis or physical, you know, photographs and so on, indirect evidence is sometimes preferred. There's also destructive and non-destructive testing. That's the nice thing about that ATR that I was telling you about, because it's non-destructive. You put a little powder on the top, you get a spectrum of it, you can collect that powder back. Okay? Acid digestion for inductively coupled plasma, mass spec, that's going to be destructive. So you're going to take that small particle that you have, you're going to dissolve it in nitric acid, and then run it on the instrument, you'll never get it back.
That's right,
and hopefully you have enough to do several runs. You don't want to just depend upon one particular run. And so you're always comparing things, how much sample will be destroyed with this technique versus that. And then the chain of custody is absolutely the most important thing in all of this. So the chain of custody is the collection of evidence and then the cataloging and tracking of that evidence all the way to trial. And it has to either be checked into the vault or checked out by a person, signed. There need to be no gaps in that chain of custody. And so this, you know, if there's a break in the chain of custody, even if you really don't think anything was done to the evidence, it just raises enough doubt. And so a lot of times things will be thrown out because of breaks in the chain of custody. So we always have this sort of flow to forensic analysis. We have the general unknown, you know, what is this substance, what is this object, and then we'll do presumptive tests, wet chemical methods and spot tests. And so the scientific working group for drug analysis, they refer to these different categories. So a category C test would be a presumptive test. There's a lot of colorimetric tests for different kinds of drugs and now explosives. So you can take a drug or some white powder you think might be an explosive, you scrape a little bit of it into a ceramic dish or into a test tube, and you add solution A, it reacts with it, and then you add solution B, and it changes color. And then you look at the color card.
Yeah.
And you go, oh, it's a bluish-green, matches this card. So that means it's a, you know, it's a opioid or something like that.
Officers are going to do that like
Yeah, and, but that doesn't really tell you which opioid it is. Is it hydrocodone? Is it morphine? Is it heroin? I mean, it just tells you it's in that general class. Then you have more specific tests, screening tests, where you have an extraction and separation. You can take a liquid-liquid extraction scheme and it stays with the acid fraction and it's always aqueous. That's going to tell you it's some kind of substance. If it goes into the organic phase, it tells you it's a different kind of substance. And so you can do this extraction and separation and then a presumptive test on that, but because you've done some separation, that puts it in category B, and then you have this instrumental analysis, category A. Those are the confirmation tests. Those are very specific to the chemical nature of the substance, and their recommendations are that you have at least two different category A tests, or a category A and two category C tests. So two different color changes plus a FTIR would be enough. Or an FTIR plus a GCMS. That would be golden, but that's expensive. You gotta have two large pieces of equipment.
And category C is enough to make an arrest, right? If they do that right then.
Yeah, a lot of times.
And category C. And then they can take it back and see what.
Well, any kind of just, you can arrest somebody and hold them, I think, for 24 hours with very little. I mean, you wouldn't even need a category C
you
to do that.
Like, I can have a baby powder.
Yeah, exactly. And so this professional analytical laboratory, which many of you are headed for, aimed towards, is so critical that you have standard practices and standard procedures. And part of that is to do these performance quality checks, right? Standard samples tell you whether the instrument's performing well or not, okay? It verifies that the signals are appropriate. And then control charts are often used. So in this course, throughout the semester, that's what we're going to be focused on in one part of this course, and that is tracking data daily. So it's not a huge burdensome task, but it's something that you need to do every day. And so you need to get into that practice when you're in a professional laboratory. There's going to be things that you do every day when you come in. And there's going to be things that you do every week and things that you do every month. It's called a preventive maintenance schedule or PM schedule. You know, the batteries in your smoke detectors or check the fire extinguishers. You know, there's going to be things that you do on a monthly basis, on a quarterly basis, and an annual basis. And so just getting your mindset correctly to work in a professional lab, we're going to start a little bit of that this semester with the control chart. And so let me go through the control chart exercise. What we're going to have is the very first thing that we'll have to do is do next Tuesday, and that is to get an approved data set. And so if you're looking at this control chart, this is for the whole semester. This is a completed one. And the way this works is you have to document how the instrument is operating. And in this case, it doesn't have to be an instrument. Like Brittany, her was her dog, okay? But the point is the data needs to vary randomly with you know, a nice smooth average. It shouldn't have a trend in it. But what is the standard deviation of that dog finding a spot? We don't know, right? And so there needs to be a 15-day period where we learn the process. And so if you're starting a new instrument, you're going to do a control chart on this instrument, you're going to have to see how the instrument behaves for a period of time before you know if it's out of control. And so this green box here, in the first 15 days, first 3 weeks, it's a 15-day training period. And so we take that data and we find the average and the standard deviation of those data points. And so the mean is that green line. And then we want to know if it's going outside of its normal behavior. And so we have plus or minus one standard deviation. Now that's a little too tight to try to hold an instrument because that only captures 63% of a randomly varying process. Okay, so what is that? 37% of the time, it's going to be outside of plus or minus one. So, you know, every three data points has a chance of being out. You don't want to control a process to plus or minus one sigma. Plus or minus two, though, then you have about a 5% chance of it being out. Okay? And so we have plus or minus one is yellow, and we call those watch limits. If it's outside of the watch limit, you watch it. Okay? But if it's outside the red, it's plus or minus two sigma away, then you need to take action. Now, action may not be turning the knob. Actually, that's a bad thing. Don't go change anything on the instrument. Just investigate. And so if you're measuring stocks, say the difference of today's stock price versus yesterday's, then you pull up the news and see if anything happened to that stock. Okay, sometimes they'll say a quarterly earnings report came out, or you know, there was a scare because Hawaii got scared by a you know, fake missile alert or something like that. And you can tie, sometimes you can investigate and see, oh, this is the problem. Like one student was tracking the stock price of Yamaha motorcycles, okay? And then the tsunami hit Japan and the nuclear power plant blew up and all of this stuff happened. And so his data went crazy for 2 days and then it disappeared for 3 days, for like a week. As they shut down the Japanese stock exchange while they were dealing with that problem, and then they brought it back up. So probably not going to have anything that severe. But you see the data stays within those red limits except for a few times. And so every one of these data points that's outside that action limit, in your little log, you'll say an action limit log or action log, you'll say on whatever date, you know, the 11th of April, it was greater than, you know, less than 2 sigma than the mean, or the sigma minus 2, the mean minus 2 standard deviations, and it was low, so you investigate and you write out what you found. Yes.
We also need to consider the conditions of the 15-day training period too, though, right? Like in the case of the dog, it depends on what time of the year. Maybe the different times of the year would reflect the.
Yeah, and to that point, I don't like when I said you need to get an approved data set. I won't let you use temperature straight out, okay? Measuring temperature, because what is temperature going to do as we go into May? We hope. It's kind of like this, right? And so that's not a controlled process.
Yeah.
It has a trend. Now, how do you subtract a trend? You take the difference. And so you take today, listen carefully, today minus yesterday. Because if the temperature went down, we want it to be a negative number. So it's always the current minus the previous. Everybody, if you're going to do a difference, write that down. If you get that backwards, I'm going to count off. So if you're doing a daily difference, it's the current day minus the previous day. Because if it drops, you want it to be negative, and if it goes up, you want it to be positive. And that ordering is important.
Okay, I was thinking that on the topic of the stocks, like what if you started the 15-day training period during a really good time, and then all of a sudden you start doing your actual recording, and then everything drops, something like that.
Now what's interesting is that two things can actually change. The direction of the line, right? High, it could be high or low. But another thing that can change, which occasionally we see, but this is pretty rare, is the standard deviation can change. So sometimes during the training period, it can be really narrow standard deviation, and then all of a sudden, boom, it's all over the place. And so what's happened is the standard deviation has changed, and you've got way more points outside your limits than you would expect. There should be a 5% chance of them being out of bounds. So that means one out of every 20 points, and that's about right. About one out of every 20 points, you get out. It's not 20 points and then one and then 20. It's not that normal, but like you have two, and then you have a whole bunch with none, and then you have a couple more. So this is in control. Even though there's 4 points out of control, you expect one out of every 20 points to be right at that limit. Okay, so in Excel, where we're going to collect this data, for the first 3 weeks, you're just going to submit an Excel data sheet. And I want to see your data, grow. The first week, you have 5 points, and then 10, and then 15. So you just add those points. And they'll be day stamped. Okay, and you can do it by day, and you have the data in there. And then after the training period, you'll come up here, and you'll do the mean, or the average, of those first 15, and then that's it. You don't run that average the whole semester. You just average those first 15, because that's the training period. And then the standard deviation is just the standard deviation for those first 15. And then that sets your bars all the way across. So if you're constantly averaging, the average is going to move. And if you're constantly taking the standard deviation, they're going to move, and we don't want that. We want just a single average for the first 15 days, and we're going to plot that, and it's going to be one number the whole semester. And then we have one standard deviation. It's the same error bars, or watch bars, that go across the whole semester. And so once we have those, then we have the mean plus one standard deviation. So it's this plus, so this is the mean plus the standard deviation. See how it's the same number all the way down? So that's your positive watch limit. The mean minus the standard deviation is your negative watch limit. And then plus 2s, so that's the mean plus 2 times the standard deviation. You see how it's the same number all the way down. And then you just plot all of these. Now I like to do this and put in a little if-then statement. If DH greater than HA or less than I8, so you can do that with the Boolean OR function, then you can tell me, hey, it's beyond the action level. And so if you put that if-then statement here, then you'll get an alert. It'll show up in your table. And so that's a nice little trick. And so then you plot this whole thing. You've got to plot the mean is green, the watch is yellow, and the action is red. And I want those colors. I want it formatted just like this. Okay. So after the 4th week, then you'll start turning in your control charts each week. And so then the whole semester, everybody's control charts will grow. And if I see anything really interesting, I'll show it in class or put it out on an announcement or something like that. Okay. Now there is an example final report. Oh yeah, what's wrong with this one? You see? That's a sloping, thing, and that's a problem, right? That's not in control. Okay. So what you would do is you take differences, and that would drop it back down onto the mean. What you want every morning, you know, if you're in a forensic lab and you want to run a check sample under GC or whatever, you boot it up, ready to go. It does its self-check, and then you run a standard sample on there, and let's say you're tracking retention time. You know, and it's plus or minus a few, you know, tenths of a minute. Okay, but you just keep marking that on there. You take today minus yesterday, and so on, and you see that it's just cruising right along. And then all of a sudden, it goes out of control, and you're like, "What's wrong?" Well, the inlet needs to be cleaned, or you know, something's wrong with it. And so this control chart philosophy is based upon the pull philosophy. If you're using calibration schedules, it's called a push philosophy, meaning I'm going to recalibrate no matter what every week. And there may be requirements that you have to do that. But control charts operate on a pull philosophy, meaning I'm only going to change something on my instrument when my instrument goes out of control. Maybe my instrument goes for a week and a half. That saves me a lot of money. You think it doesn't save a lot of money? Well, instead of calibrating 50 times a year, now I calibrate like 40. Okay, that's not billable time. I can't bill you, the prosecutor or the defense, for me checking my instrument or recalibrating. Okay, and at the end of the day, a lot of it is about money. If I could stretch my weekly calibration schedule to 8 days or 10 days and do it every 2 weeks, and I can prove that my instrument is still in good shape using control charts, then I've done a great thing. Okay. So I've gone from 50 calibrations a year down to 25. And yet I can prove with the control chart that my instrument's still rocking along. So that's what I mean by pull. When the instrument's not rocking along, I get to 9 days and I'm supposed to go to 10, or I typically can go to 10, and it starts going crazy on day 9, and then I recalibrate on day 9. And then it goes for another month or two, and now it starts crapping out at day 8 or day 7. Then I realize my instrument may be getting old. It's not able to go as long as it used to on a particular calibration. And so that's it for today. Any questions about the data? Let's talk about that for a little bit.
In the case of that increasing slope slide you showed, would you take the derivative of that?
So today minus yesterday would be how you fix that. And so temperatures are fine if you want to do differences. Okay? It's like you want to do a temperature in Huntsville or Texas or whatever, daily differences, that's fine. That works well. Stocks, again, differences in stocks, that's fine. You want to do closing price, something easy to look up. The reason you want something like that you can find on the internet is so that, you know, you can go and investigate it too.
To see why it changes.
Yeah, if you really, now the investigation, I'm not talking about like a whole report. I'm talking about two sentences. Okay. The point is, it's an action limit. You took action. Okay. So you can't. You know, I don't want to set you up and approve your data if I think it's going to do this. So like temperature would do this. We hope. Okay. What is the problem with this one though? This is an issue that we can't have either. Ooh. What do you see here in this data?
The jumps in data.
Really big jumps.
Yeah.
And the same jumps every time, right? This is called digital noise, right? The needle can't vary. It goes tick or there. You know, there's nothing in between. And so this is like gas prices, okay? So if it's a real stable period and it goes up 2 cents, you know, and then down 1 penny, and then down 4 cents, and then up a penny. You know, it only changes by 1 penny. And so you might see this. And especially this is bad when it happens during the training period, and then all of a sudden it jumps up here, and it's kind of a mess. Or this was what you'd see if you were doing differences in gas price, right? It's the same, the same, the same, so 0, 0, 0, and then it goes up by 1 penny. You know, then it's the same, back to 0. And so you see these digital jumps. You need to have continuously variable data. Meaning you need to have, I would prefer 10, you know, let's say within the one or the plus or minus standard deviation, one standard deviation, I'd prefer at least 10 tick marks You know, like you could have at least 10 values between your standard deviations. So if you're going to measure time, measure it in hundredths of seconds. Okay, you don't need to go to thousands, but hundredths, you know, on a short process. Okay, like that dog finding a spot in the morning, she was measuring that to hundredths on her phone. So it wasn't, you know, 12 seconds or 13 seconds, it was 12.22, okay, or 12.42. You know, so it had a lot of, it was more analog than digital. You see what I'm saying? That's what we're after. Then you get good statistics. Regular, you know, standard deviation statistics with a Gaussian distribution function don't apply to something like this. Right? Because that's really not randomly varying. It's digital tick marks. Okay? For something like this, you need to use the hypergeometric function. Who's going to do that? Anybody going to use hypergeometric? You ever heard of it? Right? So you wouldn't use that.
I've heard of it.
You want to use Gaussian statistics. So for Gaussian statistics, you need to use a data procedure or a data source that has a lot of variation. Stock price might be a problem, okay, in that sense, because it's to cents, hundredths of a dollar. But if you're taking differences, and you know, typically it's been okay. We've seen enough variation in the closing price, enough volatility in the market to give us a decent thing. So.